It's absolutely fantastic to have you with us this morning. Are you looking forward to it?
Very much, yeah. My two children, Georgina and Lucas, are very excited. They've followed Diary of a Wimpy Kid, so it'll be a really good to meet the author, actually, as well. So good inspiration for children and writing and, you know, the creative side of a child's development. So looking forward to it very much.
These books have meant so much to kids all around the world. What do you think it is about these particular books, these particular films, that young people have been able to identify with so clearly wherever they come from?
I think because they're very much in their language and they're fun, a bit cheeky as well, a bit irreverent. And, you know, growing up, I think we all like to think we were sort of on the edge of what was right and maybe just, you know, a little bit naughty occasionally. So I think those books, really, the way they're written, the graphics, you know, the way they're put together is very much, you know, in diary format for which kids enjoy. I mean, my daughter keeps a diary and, you know, she just writes down all her thoughts, scribbles little drawings, and I suppose it's a connection between the author and the children that he's trying to connect with.
Do you ever keep a diary when you were a little, Graham?
Not really, no, I didn't. I did keep a diary when I was playing football, though, so particularly when I was injured, it was a good way of seeing how your progress was. I had a very bad injury, and keeping a diary through that process was a really good way of just seeing the little improvements and actually looking back and saying, well, I have improved this month, because at the time it doesn't really feel like you are. So I have kept diaries. I think we've always encouraged the children to do that as well, just, you know, whether it's doodling, just writing down some thoughts. And I think it's a nice thing to have if you're disciplined enough to keep a diary. It's a great thing to have to look back on and actually see what you thought and what was going on. You know, even things that seem mundane can bring a smile to your face when you get older.
I mean, talking about football, obviously it's a slightly tough time for the game at the moment. I guess it's a serious question, but how big a problem do you think that prejudice and intolerance is at the top flight level?
Well, I mean, you have to keep things in perspective. You know, first and foremost, you know, it's 100% zero tolerance in terms of everybody supporting anybody that brings, comes forward and says that they've either been abused or you know, whether it's a supporter with chanting. You know, it's absolutely important that all of us together do as much as we can to make sure that there are zero incidents. But the reality is that we live in a society where, unfortunately, there is prejudice, and football is no different. And it's up to us, whether it's, you know, individually as at a club or the Football Association, to make sure that they deal with these cases when they come about. But there have been a couple of incidents in the last year, but overall, the amount of good football has done for equality, for making sure different cultures are included. You only have to look at any football team and look at the different nationalities that are playing and the harmony within that team to see that football does a great job. And that's not just at sort of the top level, that's at grassroots all the way through. So, you know, I'm really proud of how far my sport's come in the 20 years that I've been involved with it. But there's always work to do, because it's about educating people and making sure that sort of, that, you know, the ignorance that surrounds prejudice and racism is continually addressed.
I think obviously there have been some criticisms of the ineffectiveness perhaps of some of the bodies and the campaigns that are tackling particularly racism in the game. How do you feel about that? I mean, obviously you feel like there's been a lot of progress, but do you feel like there maybe perhaps needs to be more teeth to some of the campaigns that are attacking?
Not necessarily. I think the problem is that you know, any form of prejudice, it can, you have to have different sort of punishments for different crimes, so to speak, because it's a very complex issue. So, you know, you have to constantly look at what the disciplinary charge is for particular offences. And I don't agree. I think, you know, I think all the governing body, you know, whether it's the FA, whether it's the Premier League, the rules and regulations at each club, I think are robust. But they're always open for change and check. And really for me, it's a case of each individual has a responsibility, whether you're a player, a supporter, somebody who works for a club. And I think as long as everybody sticks together, you know, we can continue to do our best to limit the amount of cases that occur within, you know, within football stadium. What happens outside is really hard for us to control. But what we do is try to educate people away, try to give them the information so that they, as young people, grow up seeing everybody as equal?
On a slightly more positive note, as a Blackburn fan, I have to ask, obviously, it's an interesting time for the club in general, but Henning stepping back into the hot seat, are you excited to see that? Did you know at the time you were playing with him that he was going to go on to be a manager?
Well, it's great to see Henning back. I think he was given the job because of his playing history at the club, and he's been obviously coaching as well. It's been a difficult start for him, and I think there's a lot of structure that needs to be put into the club to get them supported, get them back into the Premier League. It's not going to happen overnight, but obviously, having played for Blackburn for 4 years myself, and seeing Henning there, I wish him and the supporters, the team, all the best. And if they put a good run of games together, they do have a squad that's good enough to get back into the Premier League. But what you've got to do is the owners have to look at a long-term plan of sort of making sure that the club can sustain some relative success. And I'm always very proud of talking about Blackburn, because the time I had there was absolutely fantastic, and I hope they do well.
Obviously, the supporters have magnificent memories of those times that are sustaining them at the moment. Can you maybe just talk a little bit about, looking back on that, is there a particular moment, I assume lifting that trophy, but that really stands out to you and makes you smile every time you think of it?
Well, I had a roller coaster time at Blackburn. I left Chelsea, went to Blackburn, had the first year we were at the club, we finished fourth in the Premier League, second year second, and the third year we won the Premier League. And it was an amazing rise, and we all did it together, as a club. So it's far more than the team. It's it's the management team. It's the backroom staff. The chairman, obviously Jack Walker, investing in the club in the way he did, in a very clever way, building the stadium. All of that happened whilst we were there, the new training facilities. So it was a work in progress, but within that we still did well, and we took the supporters on this journey that was just, it was unbelievable. And to look back, you can really see what an achievement it was by everyone involved at the club. Now that we all hope that would be the sort of the basis of the future of the club, but it's been a very unsettled period for Blackburn. Almost as soon as we won the Premier League, it became an unsettled period for the club, and it is difficult. It's a very difficult. Once you've been successful, it's very difficult to maintain that success. And now, we're in a new era for Blackburn Rovers, and I only hope that the owners, get behind the manager, invest in the team in the right way, in a sensible way, and give the supporters something to be really positive about, because in the last season and a half, it's been a very very difficult time for everyone involved at the club, and I've seen the frustration from people on Twitter and in the press, and ultimately you've got to get to a point where you draw a line under it and start to build again, and hopefully with Henning there and if the club have a good run, that could be the basis of hopefully some future success.
Fingers crossed for that. Chelsea fans would be very annoyed if I don't ask you what you think of the manager merry-go-round there. Obviously, quite a lot of criticism, I guess, about the speed at which they're going through the managers. But what do you think?
Well, again, it's Chelsea. I work for the club, and the decision that's made, at board level, is the decision, and everybody involved, whether it's players or people like myself who work behind the scenes, we have to accept that and move on. I think the club, in terms of the players, it's a fantastic set of players, but are going through a difficult time, and I think that's down to the players. They need to sort of look at themselves and regroup. Dismiss any thoughts that are distracting them from what they need to do on the pitch. And again, it's all about the results. If they start getting the results, then supporters begin to see that the club are moving on again. But until they do that, there's always going to be a fear and an anxiousness around the club. But overall, when I look at how far we get, Chelsea as a club have come in the last 10 years, it's absolutely phenomenal. And what Roman has done in terms of building a legacy is incredible, whether it's the training facilities, state-of-the-art, youth academy, all the community work that we do, the foundation work that we do. It's phenomenal, but all people are interested, on a day-to-day basis is the headline, which is how are the team doing, how are they performing? And it's up to us that sit behind that team to make sure that we're consistent in what we deliver.